Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is David Gloucester, and I'm delighted to welcome you to the Royal Institute of British Architects and to the 2016 President's Medal Ceremony, our annual celebration of architectural education and research. Well, we're here to reward achievement by students, their tutors and practitioners and researchers at all stages of architectural training, from undergraduate to postgraduate, and in academic and professional research. For the RIBA, this is much more than an awards ceremony. The President's Medals are a celebration of excellence and innovation in architecture, both as a discipline and as a profession, that the Institute has proudly promoted on behalf of the architecture community for more than 180 years. And to tell you a little more about tonight's awards and their importance to the RIBA, please join me in welcoming to the stage the Chief Executive of the RIBA, Alan Valance.
Thank you, David, and good evening, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm extremely pleased to join you at tonight's ceremony, not only because the achievements by the winners that you're about to see are undoubtedly deserving of their awards, but because it's a privilege to say a few words at an event that's become one of the highlights in our calendar. As you may know, the RIBA President's Medals are our oldest awards. But when it was awarded in 1836, the first RIBA Silver Medal didn't celebrate an individual or a building. Instead, it was awarded to an essay as a recognition of the importance of education, critical thinking and knowledge, not just for architects, but for all men and women. The essay was a detailed investigation on the structural properties of concrete, and it was awarded to George Godwin, who went on to win the RIBA Gold Medal, the Royal Gold Medal, in 1851, and established the Godwin Bursary to enable young British architects to study modern techniques of construction outside of Great Britain. For the Institute's founders, individuals educated into the benefits of better spaces were by nature more tolerant, healthier, and happier citizens, contributing to the creation of prosperous and cooperative communities at local, national, and international levels. In 1837, this ethically noble view of education became enshrined in our Royal Charter, and it's remained at the heart of our beliefs and values ever since. We'll start tonight's celebrations by announcing the winner of the RIBA's Annie Spink Award for Excellence in Architectural Education, which we award biennially to a tutor who's made an outstanding contribution to architectural education. This will be followed by the announcement of the winners of the 2016 RIBA President's Awards for Research and of the RIBA Research Medal. We'll then announce this year's winners of the President's Medals in three different categories. The Dissertation Medal for the best written work submitted at RIBA Part 1, 2 or equivalent. The Bronze Medal for the best design project produced during Part 1. And the Silver Medal for best design project submitted for Part 2. As well as the winners of the Sargent Awards for Excellence in Drawing and of the SOM Foundation Fellowships. This year, the RIBA invited the largest ever number of schools of architecture in the history of the awards to take part in the celebration of excellence and talent. A record 350 institutions located in 71 countries were invited to nominate dissertations and design projects. And for months, hundreds of entries arrived on our doorstep from all over the world. After several days of judging, our panels agreed on the medal and commendation winners that you'll see tonight. This evening also marks the opening of the 2016 President's Medals exhibition, which you can see in the practice space, which is our gallery on the second floor of the building here. This exhibition features a selection of entries printed on individual panels by our printing partner, Callprint, And once it closes in London at the end of January next year, it will tour throughout the UK and indeed internationally. And to celebrate this year's President's Medals winners with all of our members, we produced a special supplement to be distributed with the December edition of our media partner, the RIBA Journal, a fantastic publication. It can be found in 20,000 postboxes from tomorrow morning, but you can help yourselves to a copy here tonight after the ceremony. Finally, I'd like to thank the RIBA staff who worked tirelessly over the many months to make these awards happen. And I'd like to thank you, the hardworking teachers, talented students, and inquisitive practitioners for pushing the boundaries of architecture. On behalf of the Institute, we thank you for your unfaltering commitment to the profession and for your continuing support for education and building better communities. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Alan. And now to start announcing the winners of tonight's awards, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming to the stage the president of the RIBA, Jane Duncan.
Thank you very much, David. Well, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us this evening. I'm really, really pleased to see in this auditorium so many talented architecture graduates and the tutors who worked so hard to shape their potential and get them to be the best in their future professions. As we celebrate 180 years of the RIBA President's Medals this year, I couldn't feel more honoured to be standing here before you and to host tonight's ceremony, because I feel genuinely reassured that the future of architecture can be safely entrusted to a highly talented and capable generation of emerging architects. As I revisited the winning work produced by so many talented graduates, tutors, and practitioners to find inspiration to write these words, I found myself not only in awe of the outstanding talent and hard work evident in every narrative and in every image, but mostly pleased that teachers and students continue to forge innovative career paths that will undoubtedly enrich the future of architecture. Normally, anniversary celebrations of any kind tend to look past to the past for examples of accomplishment. But the more time I spent with this year's award-winning work, the more I realized that rather than looking back, we should hold the 180th anniversary of the RIBA President's Medals as a celebration of the future. The quality and diversity of the projects we will see tonight should make us all feel extremely proud of the next generation of our fellow colleagues and be confident that the future of architecture is indeed in very good hands. I'm humbled by the way that students have so confidently addressed issues that stem from their own personal interests and indeed how develop them into grounded and solid architectural proposals with the guiding hands of their tutors. Equally, the design proposals and investigative writings by this year's award-winning researchers are truly remarkable in their creative ambition and accomplished resolution. It's particularly heartening to note the very international and diverse profile of this year's awards, and with the winners hailing not only from the UK, but also from Canada, China, Cyprus, Eritrea, Israel, Finland, Hong Kong, Italy, Pakistan, Romania, New Zealand, and Sri Lanka. How marvelous is that? Mirroring this diversity, the international dimension of the RIBA President's Medals exhibition has also grown to unprecedented levels. Over the past few years, and in collaboration with universities, art galleries, and museums, we've been able to showcase the entries submitted for the President's Medals across the globe and demonstrate that supporting architects and celebrating architecture is at the heart of what we do. This year alone, the President's Medals exhibition was visited by thousands on the streets of Bogota in Colombia, at the Institute for Innovation and Creative Strategies in Architecture in Lyon, France, at the Centre for Environmental Planning and Technology in Ahmedabad, India, at the University of Belgrade, Serbia, at the Beirut Arab University in Lebanon, and at the Bibliotheca Alexandrina in Egypt. There we go, you can see some of it. And I'm very pleased to announce that we have already scheduled venues to host the 2016 President's Medals exhibition. Over the next few months, it will be in Saudi Arabia, in Sharjah, in Oman, in Bahrain, in Mexico, in Serbia, India, Italy, and Argentina. So I hope you enjoy tonight's celebration of our Institute's rich history of supporting excellence and innovation in architectural education, while looking forward to the future and to the next 180 years with confidence and with excitement. Thank you.
Thank you, Jane. We now move to the announcement of our first award of the night, the RIBA Annie Spink Award for Excellence in Architectural Education. In 1974, the RIBA established the Annie Spink Trust Fund after a bequest by architect Herbert Spink in memory of his late wife Annie, and conceived as an honour for the advancement of architectural education. Since it was first awarded in 2000, the biennial Annie Spink Award has recognised the outstanding contribution to architectural education made by an individual in a school of architecture anywhere in the world that offers courses validated by the RIBA. Over the years, the award has attracted an impressive list of nominees, whose remarkable careers made them all deserving of this prize. 2016 was absolutely no exception, with the judges tasked with the decision to select a winner from amongst a number of outstanding nominees. This year's panel, chaired by RIBA Head of Education Projects John Paul Nunes, included Alan Jones, RIBA Vice President Education and Director of Education for Architecture at Queen's University Belfast, Zeno Bogdanescu, Professor of Architecture at the Ion Mincu University of Architecture and Urbanism, Bucharest, Romania. Susanna Hagen, Professor of Architecture at the University of Westminster and Director of RED, Research into an Environment and Design. Baz Makaki, RIBA Bronze Medalist 2011, founding partner of Studio Bound, and director and tutor of the Architectural Association Visiting School in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. And Alan Penn, professor in architectural and urban computing, dean of the Bartlett Faculty of the Built Environment, UCL. The judges were unanimous in their decision that the 2016 RIBA Annie Spink Award would go to Professor Christine Hawley. Christine completed her Architectural Association Diploma in 1975. During her studies, she worked for the Department of Environment, and with practices such as Renton, Howard Wood and Levin, the Louis de Soissons Partnership, and York, Rosenberg and Model, YRM. In 1975, she became a partner in Cook and Hawley Architects, and in 1978, registered as a British architect and practiced with Pearson International. In 1998, she established Christine Hawley Architects. Her academic career is long and distinguished. Since 1979, she's taught at numerous architectural schools in the UK and abroad, and held visiting professorships in 24 institutions across Europe, Asia, Australia, and the USA. She has lectured extensively and participated in over 100 international exhibitions and contributed to over 150 publications. From 1979 to 1987, she taught at the Architectural Association in London. And from 1987 to 1993, she was head of the School of Architecture at the University of East London. In 1993, she became Professor of Architectural Studies at the Bartlett School of Architecture, and in 1999 was made Dean of the Faculty of the Built Environment and Head of School at the Bartlett. Since 2015, Christine has held the title of Professor of Architectural Design. She has been advisor for professorial appointments in 15 universities across the world and contributed to over 50 committees that advised universities, charitable foundations, and governments in the UK and abroad. Christine is a committed teacher, academic leader, and designer, and is exceptional in that her career has embraced a uniquely broad range of experience, which has made her, above all, an inspirational educator for generations of architects and academics. Tonight, Christine receives not only the Annie Spink Trophy, but also a bound volume containing the 100 letters of citation from past and current employers, work colleagues, students and graduates that formed her nomination. A truly emotive testament to how her intellect, hard work, determination, and inspiring leadership have enriched the global landscape of architectural education. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating the winner of this year's RIBA Annie Spink Award for Excellence in Architectural Education, Professor Christine Hawley.
First of all, I'd just like to say how incredibly flattered I am to have been nominated for this award. I mean, this award has been won by some absolutely extraordinary people, and I just feel absolutely honoured to be part of that group. I'd also like to say that my family have told me that I mustn't do an Oscar thank you speech, so that, you know, you're there standing thanking every single person you've ever worked with, including the dog. So I'm not going to do that. But what I have done, once I was told I was going to receive this award, is that I reflected, I think, a lot more carefully on the people that I worked with. Not just the people that I taught, but also the people I taught with, the people that I've taught alongside, and actually the people, most importantly, who helped me run two schools of architecture and also the faculty. My career path has not been smooth. It has not been sort of a gilded career path at all. I started out as a student at the AA, having been taught by Peter Cook and Ron Heron. And I think rather prematurely, I was invited back to teach. And on the first day, I was waiting for the first student to turn up, and nobody turned up at all. And I waited and waited. And eventually, one brave soul, the wonderful late Catherine Finlay, turned up. And she was the first, and I have to say, the only student that I taught during that year. So for all of you hard-pressed tutors sitting in studios with tons and tons of people queuing up, just think of the luxury that I had, one student in 1 year. To say that I taught her, I think, is a bit of an exaggeration. We just had a really good time talking about architecture and me marvelling at her amazing drawings. But that was my start. Like a lot of young people, I then did a second job, which was teaching at East London. And I found myself, and I won't go into the details why, I found myself in an interview eventually, an interview for being the head of the school. And after I'd done the interview, the chairman of the Board of Governors turned round and said to me, I'm terribly sorry, Christine, but we're not going to offer you the job. We're not offering it to you because you're a woman and you can't command the respect and the authority that we need in a head of department. And that was that. And so I walked out the door and the rector, who I have to take my hat off to, organised another interview the following day. Well, I say interview in inverted commas. And I walked in and he said how sorry he was and how embarrassed, and I got the job. So that was my first headship. It was quite extraordinary. Going to work at East London was absolutely fantastic, and I will tell you why. It was one of two schools that had actually been deregistered by the RIBA because they were so bad. It was, I have to say, not a job where there was a stampede of people trying to line up to be the head of the of one of two schools, and I'm not going to name the other one, one of two schools that had actually lost its RIBA status. But I have to say, it was fantastic. It was like the Wild West. It was, you could do absolutely anything and everything. And I hadn't got a clue how to run a school of architecture, but I just sort of carried on through instinct. It was an amazing learning curve, but I actually managed to gather around me some extraordinary people, really extraordinary people, and they in turn actually attracted some extraordinary students. And I think the rest is history, because it then went on to win the bronze and the silver medal and so on. So for me, that was a terribly important part of my life. I then went on into a very different sort of environment, the Bartlett, into UCL, much more formalised, where the protocols had been long established over centuries. And suddenly I found myself having to be a grown-up in committee meetings, and endless committee meetings, actually. But I was there with an old colleague, Peter Cook, and together we also managed to gather around us some extraordinarily invigorating people, people with fresh ideas, people that were ready to push the boundaries, people that challenged actually the status quo. And it was quite a roller coaster, I have to say. I mean, it really was quite extraordinary. Again, you know, I absolutely loved it. But I then went on to be the dean of the faculty and then plunged into what was called the research assessment exercise. And I didn't really know very much about that either. And so the thing is that I actually felt the people around me really probably ought to have taken far more credit than they did. So as having been head of two schools and also the dean of a faculty, I think I'm probably in a situation where I can observe how tremendously important it is that everybody is recognised and supported, and that actually to make a good school of architecture is an enormous, but enormous collaborative effort. It is not the effort of one single person at all. There's just one last thing I'd like to say, and it's something that I very, very rarely talk about, and it's actually because I'm the first woman to receive the Annie Spink Award. And I'd like to say that all of the opportunities that are out there that are offered by the architectural profession, whether it's for academia or whether it's for practice, should be equally available to both men and women, and that is terribly, terribly important. And thank you so much for coming to support me in getting this fantastic award. Thank you very much indeed.
Congratulations, Christine. We'll now move to the announcement of the 2016 RIBA President's Awards for Research and of the winner of the Research Medal. This year's President's Awards for Research Judging Panel was chaired by Peter Clegg, senior partner at Field & Clegg Bradley Studios, and included Amika Dahl, director of Assemble, Hattie Hartman, sustainability editor at the Architects Journal, Professor Robert Mull, head of school at the University of Brighton, Dr. Eileen Orbashley, reader in architectural regeneration at Oxford Brookes University, and Professor Christopher Platt, head of the McIntosh School of Architecture at the Glasgow School of Art, and founding director of Studio Cap Architects. These judges selected a shortlist of 12 papers from 75 entries to read over the summer, and then met at the RIBA to select the winners in each of this year's four new categories. The categories are history and theory, city and community, design and technical, and the annual theme, learning from projects. Out of the category winners, they then decided which would be awarded the 2016 Research Medal. And this year, to give you a feel of the judging process and the diversity of the research submissions, we asked our judges to tell you about the work they encountered and have included their responses in this short film.
There was a tremendous range of projects in this year's RIBA Research Awards. And what really struck me is the amount of research and practice that goes on.
We were excited about the diversity of the topics and real search for knowledge in so many different aspects of architecture.
If you extrapolate the amount of time that you as one person spend engaging with it, it's an extraordinary amount of imaginative effort and time that's invested in considering them, which is impressive.
I mean, it's both fascinating and sort of daunting to find 75 research projects, and I think it was also good there were people who had done master's dissertations, people who were just submitting chapters or early deliberations on work, and I think it's important that these are also encouraged and supported.
The quality of the work allowed us to have some quite challenging and profound conversations about the nature of research and the nature of research in relation to practice and academia.
Some of which are enormously influential in architectural practice, others which are influential in the development of the history and philosophy of architecture, which is obviously a slight distance from practice. But I think the interesting thing is the breadth of the projects that we've seen.
Just the sheer international dimension. I think what was interesting and surprising was the degree of projects which involved activism and community engagement.
Projects that had sort of multiple dimensions and engagement definitely stood out today. I think that's sort of overarching theme.
Researchers and groups of practitioners in very, very difficult circumstances sometimes, doing things which were very brave within the context. And that allowed one to really question one's own sort of ethical and political position in relation to what is good and what is bad in research terms. And I found that surprising and really powerful and very moving at times.
Many architects become architects in the first place for humanitarian reasons, because they want to make cities better places. And through this very detailed kind of micro research, which has taken place in some of these, particularly in some of the refugee settlements, it definitely highlights, you know, small moves that can improve the quality of day-to-day life.
Within architecture, if nothing else, we want to be useful, and we want that insight to be able to be applied into some other context.
It's about showing how research informs what you're doing. You can do a lot of research, you can do a lot of architecture, but how do you combine the two?
The papers that were most exciting to read for me were ones where people in practice had tried to find ways, A, recognise that as a valuable thing that they have, and B, then tried to find a way to make that approachable, like recognise it as part of their work.
The really important thing is to be very clear about what your project is about and what question your project is about. What are you trying to reveal what's the question that you're trying to answer.
I think the papers that were really strong had done that. They'd considered the research award as an independent output and had invested time and considered the audience as different to maybe the audience they'd normally be working for or working with, whether that's a client group or a different kind of academic output.
It's an interesting way of focusing your ideas and being very clear about the nature of research in practice.
So many things are dismissed as not being research because they're not recognisable in conventional terms. But within a context where there is generosity towards what they might do and achieve, have a go.
We've had some really lively discussions. We've got people who cross the boundaries between academia and practice. Those sorts of discussions are always really rewarding. The sharing of ideas is what it's all about.
Well, before awarding the category winners and research medal, judges awarded two commendations. To present them, together with the RIBA president, I'd now like to invite to the stage the chair of the RIBA Research and Innovation Group, Professor Flora Samuel from the University of Reading. The first commendation for a research paper goes to the Palestine Regeneration Team. This is a complex and multidimensional project that employs a well-established design research initiative, exploring how best to regenerate and heal fragmented places and communities on the Palestine-Israel borders. The research unites anthropology and urbanism, political and cultural studies. The project was undertaken by a collaborative team from Golzari NG Architects, the University of Westminster, and the Bartlett School of Architecture, UCL. Collecting the commendation on behalf of the team are Dr. Yara Sharif and Dr. Nasser Golzari. The second commendation goes to the project UK's first amphibious house, Canfloat Amphibious Building. This is another exemplar design research project that takes a hard look at the issues faced by communities prone to flooding, and not only proposes a solution, but actually builds one. The paper details the expert knowledge developed by the authors prior to construction, including an innovative way of meeting planning regulations by building underground in a flood risk area. It is a very useful piece of research that pushes the specific boundaries of amphibious design. The research was undertaken by Baker Architects, and the authors are Richard Coutts and Robert Barker. And now, on to the Research Award winners. Up first, the winner of the History and Theory category, entitled Asmara, Africa's Modernist City, UNESCO World Heritage nomination. Asmara in Eritrea is a capital city that represents a profoundly different attitude towards architectural heritage and its interpretation and treatment, compared to many other post-colonialist settings. It has an architectural character that exemplifies a period of intense development in the 1930s that coincided with the global proliferation of pre-war modernism. The historic urban landscape embodies in a whole city the unity of innovative urban planning and modernist architecture combined with local, natural and cultural conditions. In January 2016, Eritrea submitted its first ever application to UNESCO for inscription on the World Heritage List. The nominated site was the country's modernist capital, Asmara. The paper seeks to summarise nearly two decades of collaborative research by professionals from a wide range of disciplines in both Eritrea and overseas. The research was undertaken by the Asmara Heritage Project Team and the Bartlett School of Architecture. Representing the project tonight is its principal investigator, Edward Dennison. The next winner for the Learning from Projects category is titled Make Public, Performing Public Housing in Erno Goldfinger's Balfron Tower. As a response to the plan of London Borough of Tower Hamlets to refurbish and privatise the Balfron Tower, the author describes his collaborative work with the tower's current and former residents in the preceding 3 years, during which they campaigned for Balfron to remain a beacon for social housing. Concisely presented, this original approach uses archival material in resident workshops to inform a live refurbishment of the tower block and a reproduction of Goldfinger's own form of post-occupancy evaluation originally undertaken in 1968. Based at the Bartlett School of Architecture, UCL, the author and winning of the Learning from Projects category is David Roberts. And the penultimate winner for the category City and Community is the author of a project titled The Common Camp, Temporary Settlements as a Spatio-Political Instrument in Israel-Palestine. The project makes a timely contribution to the field of study concerning temporary settlement camps throughout the history of Israel-Palestine, where camps are architectural entities inherently related to the movement of people in space. Through a detailed analysis of the rules of the camp, the author tells a story of mobility and restraint, of change and of the fear of change. She regards the camp as a shadow which constantly follows modern politics. From the University of Cambridge, the winner of the City and Community category is Dr. Irit Katz. Our final research award for the category Design and Technical is given to the collaborative project Super Tall Timber, Design Research for the Next Generation of Natural Structure. This design research project aspires to make truly tall timber buildings a reality. Through a combination of theoretical design, digital and physical testing, the authors demonstrate the viability of timber buildings at much greater heights than have previously been possible. The result is an ambitious proposal to build the structurally and environmentally sound Oakwood Tower in the City of London. A structure that at 300 metres tall would be designated super tall. The research is the result of a collaboration between the University of Cambridge, PLP Architecture, and Smith and Woolwork Structural Engineers. Representing the team tonight, the winners of the design and technical category are Dr. Michael Ramage, Dr. Rob Foster, Simon Smith, and Kevin Flanagan. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the research medal. This year, the category winners you've just congratulated, like you, do not know which of them has won the research medal. Following lengthy discussion, the judges decided to first award a high commendation to a project that any other year might well have won the medal itself. This project is a rigorous, imaginative, and well-considered piece of research that demonstrates a highly original use of disparate research methodologies and has the potential to be a model for similar engagements elsewhere. The author, whose enthusiasm is present throughout his work, is David Roberts from the Bartlett School of Architecture. And finally, we will award the research medal itself. The production of this research is itself an enormous achievement based on many years of material and data collection that has resulted in a tremendous body of work summarized in this submission. The project's evaluation is sensitive to its local context, and its findings have the potential to deliver a profoundly transformative effect on this location. Ladies and gentlemen, the RIBA President's Medal for Research goes to Asmara, Africa's modernist city, represented again by Edward Dennison.
I wasn't told I had to give a speech this evening, but it's not fair and it's not right that a white middle-aged man should be receiving this award. As has been mentioned, this research spans two decades and reflects a truly global effort by many exceptional people, most of whom are Eritreans. However, I'd like first to acknowledge one Chinese female, Guangyu Ren, whose research was instrumental in starting this process and whose commitment has sustained it ever since. There are too many people to thank, but in the audience are my father, John Dennison, though sadly my mother, Eleanor, can't be here tonight, the current British ambassador to Eritrea, Ian Richards, and the former Norwegian ambassador to Eritrea, Morten von Asland. Thank you all. But above all, my Eritrean colleagues, Medhani Tekla Mariam and Dawit Abraha, should be collecting this award on behalf of their outstanding team at the Asmara Heritage Project. Their journeys to Britain were thwarted by the dull weight of the British immigration system, an injustice that aptly mirrors the very motive for this research: to confront basic prejudices that challenge our claims to humanity. A common theme in so many of this year's outstanding shortlisted projects, whether fighting for public housing, natural resources, or oppressed peoples. I'm immensely grateful to the RIBA and to Dr. Kat Martindale for inviting my Eritrean colleagues to this ceremony and for recognizing their extraordinary contribution to architectural knowledge through this outstanding research into their beloved capital, Asmara. I'm deeply honored to receive this award on their behalf. Thank you very much.
Congratulations to all our research category winners and to the 2016 RIBA Research Medalist team. We now come to the 2016 President's Medal, starting with the announcement of the winner of the RIBA Dissertation Medal. This year's Dissertation Medal judging panel was chaired by Professor Peg Rawls of the Bartlett School of Architecture and included Dr. Harriet Harris, Senior Tutor in Interior Design and Architecture at the Royal College of Art; Dr. Katie Lloyd-Thomas, Senior Lecturer in Architecture at Newcastle University; and Professor Philip Ursprung, Dean of the Department of Architecture at ETH Zurich. These judges read dozens of dissertations over the summer and then met at the RIBA to discuss them and select the dissertation medal. To give you an idea of what judging the medal looked like, we've captured the judges' deliberations on film.
The dissertation is really key to architectural education. The spread of work that we've seen today really commends that.
Currently, there's a lot of focus on the design and the result and the product. We tend to forget that this is only possible if there is a theoretical discursive framework.
It's particularly important because of the need of the architect to show that they engage with society, to show that they can deal with complex situations and analyse and produce an independent but a critical and informed judgement.
There's a sense of the personal, the autoethnographic within the work, and it's that diversity that we've been incredibly honoured to be able to reward within our commendations and within the medal.
I looked at the 45 entries and I would say it's a very high standard, it's a very high level of quality.
There was some really outstanding work.
So for example, we've got a thesis that deals with a city and a region which are, if you like, new to discussions about modernism and the development of the modern sensibility and intellect and architecture. And this is a piece of work which shows real potential for more discussion in that area. It adds creatively and actually very thoughtfully to a new field.
The dissertations don't only speak to the profession, they speak to other disciplines as well. And there's a confidence in the style of writing and an openness in terms of the audience engagement, which has been utterly compelling. It isn't, if you like, architecture just for architects, it's architecture for everyone.
Architectural history and theory is a very dynamic field. History doesn't mean that you just look back or you try to fixate something which has happened or you try to conserve something. It's a way to see more clearly what's happening now and perhaps also what's coming.
But it's also a question of the methods that were being used. So I think one of the pleasures of looking at the work was seeing ways of doing research that, at least for me, seem to be very much embedded in an architectural way of looking, of trying to build evidence, of finding different ways to interrogate phenomena.
Architecture is an open profession and it's open to new ideas, and we expect young people to be contributing to that discourse.
This is, I think, crucial that it remains on this global level where we meet at some place and then try to figure out, perhaps not what's the best, but where is the field going? And that's, of course, always the field which is determined by the young students and colleagues, because they are the future.
The President's Medals recognise the hard efforts of academics and their students in shaping the knowledge base of our profession. This award is so important in protecting this as an important part of the architectural canon of recognising the capabilities and talents of our future practitioners, and indeed everyone operating within the field and the discipline of architecture.
Now, this year, the judges in this category awarded three commendations in addition to the medal. To present them together with the RIBA President, I'd now like to invite to the stage RIBA Vice President Education, Alan Jones. And the first commendation in this category goes to the dissertation, A Flaneur's Guide to Boys Town, Performativity, Pride and Place. The dissertation addresses the ways in which the streetscape of Boys Town, Chicago, functions as a site for contemporary expression. To achieve this, the author unpeels the layered history of the neighborhood, the first municipally recognized gay village in the United States, by using oral histories from community members to illustrate the varied and complex ways in which we construct, alter, erase, and rebuild our surroundings as an extension of ourselves. The dissertation was supervised by Brent Carnell at the Bartlett School of Architecture, and its author is Robin Farmer. The second commendation goes to the dissertation, The House That Politics Built, Parliament of Aotearoa. This dissertation proposes a new parliamentary architecture located in the centre of Auckland City. Political events of the 2014 New Zealand election and concepts from local and international political buildings dictate the architecture of a new parliament complex, using the prioritisation of public amenity to facilitate democracy. Or that, at least, is the conceit. Because in reality, the project deploys architecture as a satirical tool for the dissection of politics, consumerism, and the media that ultimately resonates across continents. The dissertation, supervised by Kathy Waghorn and Aaron Patterson, was submitted by the University of Auckland, New Zealand. And we are delighted that its author is joining us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, the author and winner of tonight's second commendation is Tessa Ford. The third commendation in the dissertation category goes to Are You My Mother? An exploration into the bonds between people and places. The dissertation aligns qualitative and quantitative findings from place attachment studies with elements from two other disciplines that are not commonly associated, attachment theory and environmental preference research. By exploring concepts such as prospect and refuge theory alongside the phenomenon of root shock and safe haven and secure base behaviours, the author identifies a common language and theoretical framework to understand how emotions construe a sense of place and can have a great impact on architecture. The judges were impressed with this sophisticated and highly accomplished piece of work produced at Part One at London Metropolitan University and tutored by Joseph Kohlmeier. Ladies and gentlemen, the third commendation goes to Philippa Longson. And now to the winner of this year's dissertation medal. Entitled, "The Juxtaposition of Ideological Expressions, Evaluating the Urban Transformations of Yerevan, Armenia during 1915 to 2015. This dissertation discusses the contribution of Armenian-Russian architect Alexander Temanyan and his substantial work in Yerevan during the 1920s towards the creation of a national architectural style. Following the Soviet occupation in 1920, a recently formed independent state was forcefully ended. However, its nationalistic ambitions were not completely inactive throughout the foreign rule. Temanyan's 1924 master plan for the city was deeply rooted within a nationalistic rhetoric. Over time, it was widely used as an emblem to the city, presumably due to its rich political allegories and nationalistic drive. Through it, efforts were made to overcome a difficult past by erasing specific histories from the city and replacing them by the enhancement of other selected memories. Supervised by Ian Jackson, the dissertation was submitted by the University of Liverpool. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of this year's RIBA dissertation medal is Roy Khachaturian.
Say a few words. So it's a great honour to be here today, receiving this prestigious award. So I thank the RIBA for making this happen. I'd like to thank the University of Liverpool, particularly my tutor, Dr. Ian Jackson, for his excellent guidance throughout the project. Indeed, this would have not been possible without his collaborative nature and passion for innovation. I also thank Mr. Tim Finn for the support his practice provided me with during the early research period. Lastly, I'd like to thank my family for the ongoing support over the years. Special thanks to my mother and father. Thank you.
Congratulations to all our winners in the dissertation category. Now, as part of their ongoing support of the President's Medals, the UK Office of Architectural Practice, Skidmore, Owings and Merrill, also awarded the SOM Foundation Fellowships UK. Selected from this year's entries for the awards, the fellowships were judged by a panel comprising Kent Jackson, design partner at SOM, Ian Crockford, associate director Mark Barfield, Rick Nice, director David Chipperfield Architects, and Dejan Sujic, director of London's Design Museum. At part one, the SOM Foundation Fellowship goes to the project Music House Chicago, a building conceived as a public platform of social and cultural engagement to restore the heritage of urban blues, the musical genre that was born after the great migration of 6 million Afro-Americans from the rural South to the industrial North of the United States in the early 20th century. The project was tutored by Michael Lee at Kingston University, and its author and winner of the fellowship is Jack Bailey. At part two, the SOM Foundation Fellowship goes to Borrowed Scenery, Miyato Salt Farm Onsen. The project questions notions of preservation, heritage, and identity in Japan by proposing a salt farm onsen, or hot springs, to coexist with a defensive seawall project drafted by the Japanese government for Miyato Island after the devastation caused by the 2011 Tohoku earthquake and subsequent tsunami. By synthesizing two seemingly opposing worlds, the project becomes a lyrical proposal that explores the relationship of government's ambition and the island's integrity. The project was tutored by Signe Svalastoga, Edward Simpson, and Jonathan Cook at London Metropolitan University, and its author is Shanpei Ha. Congratulations to our fellows, and thank you once again to SOM. To select the winners of the 2016 RIBA Bronze and Silver Medals and the Sargent Awards for Drawing, we gathered two groups of renowned experts from academia and practice at the RIBA over two long days in mid-October. As chair of the Bronze Medal Judging Panel, I was joined by Alan Jones, RIBA Vice President Education, Director of Education Architecture at Queen's University Belfast, by Nick Clear, Head of Architecture at the University of Greenwich, Alessandra Ciancietta, Founder and Partner AWP Architects, and by Charlotte Skeen Catling, Founder and Partner at Skeen Catling de la Peña Architects. And on the silver medal judging panel, Alan and I were joined by Winka Doubledam, Professor of Architecture at the University of Pennsylvania and Director of Architectonics in New York, by Natalie Rosenzweig, Founder and Director of Rare Architecture and Unit Master at the Architectural Association, and finally by Mel Dodd, Program Director of Spatial Practices at Central St. Martin's, University of the Arts, London. After two exceptionally long but highly enjoyable days that included detailed viewing of thousands of images, hundreds of portfolios, and dozens of films and virtual reality animations, the judges selected the medal winners and agreed three commendations in each category. This is what happened over those 2 days. Thank you.
think all the work we saw was extremely accomplished.
It was a really incredible collection of work and very varied in terms of its focus. So it was a wonderful cross-section of what's happening, not only around the country, but internationally at degree level. It's very exciting.
People are starting to understand that the kind of tactile and the details are really what architecture is ultimately. It's as important in a big or a small building.
It was particularly inspiring to see how many diverse approaches to architecture we had today.
And the sort of reflective nature of looking at how architects make work, the kind of futures that architects might be developing, was certainly something that was part of all of the projects that we saw. There was an incredibly broad range of ways of working, from hand drawing and hand making through to some very, very kind of sophisticated use of computing to make images, but also computing to make models.
Young graduates have this passion to want to develop an idea with rigor, but a sense of overcoming what's expected.
All of them were incredibly diverse. They're all exquisitely beautiful. They don't feel like degree projects. They feel much more accomplished than that.
You get a sense that this is a big range of backgrounds, big range of political, social, geographic concerns.
To see such a variety and such a diversity of locations and subjects that were being considered and addressed through the work was a joy and very impressive on behalf of all of those who submitted.
Many entries were not about just designing an object, an architectural object or an urban plan, but more about agency and more about a complexity, delivering the complexity that is behind architectures.
The ambition of the projects, I think, remains incredibly high, certainly at the best level of attainment. Part of the joy of being a good designer, I think, is setting a tough problem and coming up with an aspirational solution or series of solutions.
There's no attempt to steer the decision, to follow trends. If you like, it's the universities and the students that set the trends.
Questions that people were asking, from very pragmatic small-scale architectural resolution to questions about energy or geography or the environment, right down to sort of the high street and, you know, what we see when we're walking in local communities.
There was real thought and originality in the way in which people were putting their ideas forward. It was great.
There's a genuine intellectual curiosity, there's a genuine spirit of inquiry. Students entering the President's Medals competition routinely ask and attempt to answer and generally succeed in providing a whole range of solutions to, so very successfully.
Traditional skill set of architecture is to push the boundaries of architecture and architectural representation.
What is the intellectual input in a project, and how consistent is that reflected in the design and the concepts and the way it's executed? You know, and that's an important discussion, I think. You know, it's one that doesn't come up very often.
To give students this confidence by winning such a prize or being commended with something that's been of interest is a great start to your career.
I think the value of the competition is that it provokes conversation. It asks the profession questions of itself. It asks students questions of them about how high they want to set the bar. So it's about benchmarking just how curious we wish to be.
In the bronze medal category, reserved for design work produced at RIBA Part 1 or equivalent, the judges awarded the Sargent Award for Excellence in Drawing to the project New Greenwich Civic Centre, a Transformative Architecture. The project seeks to question the very nature of Greenwich's relationship with the past by proposing a new, modern civic centre that unashamedly caters for the modern age and places adaptation, flexibility, and modern technology at the centre of its agenda. The result is a bold building that not only addresses the needs of modern society, but confidently draws attention to the role of architecture as an agent of transformation. The project was submitted by the University of Greenwich, where it was tutored by Rahesh Ram and Tom Noonan, and its author is Lucian Stefan Musano. The first of the three commendations in the bronze medal category goes to Lewis Art Foundry. The project imagines a new permanent base for the community of artists and makers of the Phoenix site in Lewis, who face losing the workspaces and homes they inhabited for 30 years as the result of a decision to redevelop the area for housing. Driving the design philosophy of the proposal is a fundamental belief that art and technology are inseparable in the creation of future living and working spaces. The project was tutored by Nick Popel at London South Bank University, and the author is Munib Ali Khan. The second commendation in this category goes to a project submitted by the Architectural Association with the title, a long title, The 30 Years of Architecture, a Short Guide on Abandoning Accumulated Memories at the Mercy of an Inclement Weather. This is a housing project for the members of a building preservation trust to reside inside a gas holder over a 30-year period and explore the possibilities of building with materials that would otherwise be deemed neither apt nor structurally sound. By doing so, they lay the basis for a sharing economy where individual needs are met on the small component-based scale. The project was supervised by Ryan Dillon, and its author and winner of the second commendation in the bronze category is Paolo Emilio Pisano. The third commendation was awarded to the project Nuclear Now. Speculating on the controversial idea that nuclear power is the way forward for our energy needs, the project proposes a new micro-generating nuclear power station in London's Greenwich Park, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. Recognising the contentious nature of their intention, the developer, a well-known Tokyo-based multinational conglomerate with a recent history of investments in the UK, creates a Japanese-themed festival within the power station, which will utilise the byproducts from the power-generating process to grow tea, farm fish for sushi, and produce exotic fruit as a way to promote nuclear power. The project was tutored by Rahesh Ram and Tom Noonan at the University of Greenwich, and the author is Samir Rahman. And now, the bronze medal. This is awarded to the best design project produced by during RIBA Part 1, or its equivalent, in a school of architecture located in one of the 71 countries invited to take part in the awards. The winning project is entitled Formless, an alternative typology for preservation. Formless takes a theoretical path informed by the ideas of Rem Koolhaas and Jorge Otero Paios towards an alternative typology for preservation. It introduces a compromise between the desire for preservation and the cultural shift necessary for architectural expansion in the city's future. Interpreting the concept of formless in preservation as a process of transforming and reframing spaces, the author redefines our views of architecture and heritage as being part of an endless architectural development. To illustrate this, the author imagines the expansion of London's Soane Museum until the year 2075. By factoring in the potential for a massive shift in the public desire for preservation, the extension of the museum turns it into an architectural workspace for repairing and creating artifacts for preservation, thus redefining the socially constructed static notions of place and their significance in history and heritage. Nominated by Newcastle University and supervised by Josep Maria Garcia Fuentes and Aldric Rodriguez Ibora, the author of the project and winner of the 2016 RIBA President's Bronze Medal is Alan Yuk Lun Chong.
Is all wet. So good evening, guys. I'm truly happy and honored to be here tonight. And I'm so grateful for having this nomination. First and foremost, thank you all the judges for giving me this award and recognition. This is the greatest encouragement for me to keep learning and studying and contributing in the architecture world. So, of course, most importantly, I would like to thank the architect, Sir John Soane. Without your architecture and ideology, I wouldn't get any inspiration, and even I wouldn't get such an architectural masterpiece for my final year project. And I would like to take this opportunity to offer my sincere gratitude to the Director of Architecture in Newcastle University, Mr. Graham Farmer, for making my university education possible. Also, my design tutors, Joseph and Audric, their encouragement and guidance helped me continue to make improvement in my work. A grateful remark to those who trigger my architectural journey, in particular Mr. Ivan Fu, Ivan Lam, Michelle Yong, and also my first architecture tutor, Mr. Thomas Kern. Your words and your work always inspire my life. I'm also blessed with my lovely friends, including Audrey Choi, Chad, Francis, Jalen, Carson Leung, Gordon Lee, Patrick Chu, Ken Chen, and Aaron Koo, who always provide me advice when I was disappointed and frustrated. And I would like to mention and appreciate Wallace Ho, Wu Chen, and Debbie, who always take care of my models and my work when I was taking shower in the studio. So lastly, I would like to thank my family, in particular my mom and Isabella Chen. I've received an unconditional love and support throughout my undergraduate study. And I will keep always improving myself in the future. And as always, thanks architecture. Thanks everyone, and enjoy tonight. Thank you indeed.
Congratulations to our Part 1 winners. We now move to the announcement of the Silver Medal winners, starting with the Sargent Award for drawing at Part 2. The judges agreed that the Part 2 entry with the best architectural drawings was The Company. Inspired by Joseph Conrad's Heart of Darkness, this project imagines the impact of an exiled German revolutionary from 1848 on local and national identity, and explores concepts of power and control in architecture, isolation, politics, religion, and social class. Set on the remote German island of Helgoland over the course of 150 years, the narrative responds not only to local events, but to the wider history of Germany, whereas the architecture is experienced from the perspective of a fictional character named Eliza Hecker and presented as a graphic novel. The project was tutored by Adam Cole and George Thompson at the University of Kent, and its author is James Bussey. The first commended project at Part 2 is called, more or less, Bricks. Situated between two railway lines in Peckham Rye, uniting a market hall and a church, the project investigates how to design environments using aleatoric methods, inspired by the musical theories of John Cage. Rather than resorting to conventional plans or sections, prototypes, details, and for one-to-one explorations, the proposed building is designed in a way that challenges intentionality, usually considered to be the essence of a design project, and instead integrates accidental occurrences. The author was tutored by Sean Griffiths, winner of the 1991 RIBA Dissertation Prize, at the University of Westminster, and her name is Molly de Courcy Wheeler. The second commendation goes to the project Centre for Ethno-Elephantology, a cross-species design initiative. Submitted by the City School of Architecture in Colombo, Sri Lanka, where it was supervised by Tamara Wijayapala, the project's main aim is to question the notions of boundary and identity in urban design. To achieve this, it investigates a new architectural typology for villages and structures in sensitive borderland areas where cities meet animal habitats, to ultimately develop a symbiotic relationship between different species, namely humans and elephants. We are delighted that the author of the project flew from Sri Lanka to be with us tonight. Ladies and gentlemen, the winner of the second commendation in the silver medal category is Robin Ribera. The third commendation in this category goes to Visitor Centre for Petty Avesi Old Church. The project develops a proposal for a contemporary wooden addition to an existing cultural landscape in Finland that has, as its focal point, an historical monument renowned for exemplary use of wood as a building material. The new visitor centre aims to reflect the use of wood and other essential architectural qualities of the old church by applying them to contemporary timber construction methods. The project was supervised by Pekka Häkkinen at the Aalto University in Finland, an institution taking part in the President's Medals for the very first time. And its author, who we are extremely pleased was able to join us tonight, is Mikki Ristola. And finally, and you have been very patient, this year's RIBA Silver Medal for Best Design Project of RIBA Part 2 or equivalent worldwide. The winning project is called Crafts Vault, the V&A Academy of Artisanal Crafts. It was developed as a response to the uncertain future of traditional crafts industries in the UK, under threat by the economic downturn and the rise of new manufacturing technologies. The author proposes a new typology of museum building that incorporates crafts workshops into an extension of the Victorian Albert Museum in London. And this softens the boundary between visitors and the origins of exhibits, making artisanal skills relevant again and recovering the crafts industry. Situated at a strategically chosen brownfield site in North Kensington, left by a local gasworks, the project acts not just as a crafts museum, but as an archive of knowledge and an academy for retrieving the lost touch of crafts. The project was developed under the supervision of Peter Winston Ferretto and Ingrid Schroeder, and was nominated by the Chinese University of Hong Kong. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in congratulating and welcoming to the stage the winner of the 2016 RIBA Silver Medal, Thomas Chi.
Thank you, thank you. It's absolutely my great honor to be here on the stage to receive the silver medal tonight. First of all, my deepest thanks to the RIBA and the judges for this award, which is a truly exceptional recognition for my project. I want to thank the Chinese University of Hong Kong for the support. I want to thank my thesis tutor, Peter Ferretto, who has always been supportive and pushing me forward and beyond my limit. I want to thank Ingrid Schroeder, my tutor in University of Cambridge, who encouraged me to pursue my interest and open my mind. I also want to thank all teachers that have given me guidance in my studies. And last but not least, I want to thank my mom and dad, my sisters, and all my friends for their warm support and long-term support and throughout my journey as a master's student. Thank you all very much.
How fantastic. Congratulations to all of our winners, and of course to the universities that nominated them. A big, big round of applause to the universities of Liverpool, Newcastle University, and the Chinese University of Hong Kong for receiving the RIBA President's Medals for the first time in the history of these awards. Wonderful. It truly is a privilege to be president of an institute that for 180 years has rewarded talent, innovation, and excellence in architectural thinking with these medals. I'm very grateful to the RIBA members of staff, and David and John Paul particularly, who I know worked so very, very hard for months to make these awards happen. Of course, to the judges for giving us their time and expertise to select the winners, and to all of the students and the tutors whose hard work and devotion continue to make the RIBA President's Medals a celebration of excellence recognized around the world. I hope you agree with me that the future of architecture is safe in the hands of extremely talented young men and women. I hope that you continue to enjoy tonight's celebration by joining us at a drinks reception upstairs in the Florence Hall. And don't forget to visit the exhibition, and do help yourselves to a complimentary copy of the exclusive supplement featuring this year's winners that's produced in association with the RIBA Journal. Thank you all so much for coming, and do enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you.